Good afternoon, all of you. So I welcome all of you to my lecture session on carbohydrate metabolism. So in this session, we will discuss in detail about glycogenesis and glycogenolysis. Okay, this lecture is in continuation of my previous lectures on carbohydrate metabolism. So in the last three lectures, we had seen three topics. That is, one is high energy compounds. The second one is carbohydrate metabolism, glycolysis, and then Krebs cycle. So these are the three things that we had seen, and in this lecture session we'll see on glycogenesis and glycogenolysis. Before entering into the actual topic, let's have a brief discussion on energy storage in human bodies. So why energy is stored in human body is the first question that we have to ask. Okay, let's say when we are doing any kind of work, we are consuming energy. So let's say when we don't have any mechanism for storage of energy, then how actually we can survive? So we have to continuously eat and work means whatever you are doing, even while listening to this lecture also, you are supposed to eat and work. Okay, so that is not what we have right now. So we are eating food in excess because the carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, etc., we eat a little bit excess so that the excess energy we will store. Okay, that is the way how our system works. So here actually we start from blood glucose. So when we have blood glucose, it has many fates. So whatever we had seen, that let's say when we need energy, blood glucose will be converted to pyruvic acid. The pyruvic acid will be converted to acetyl coenzyme A, and then the acetyl coenzyme A will enter into Krebs cycle so that total energy from glucose is extracted. Let's say when our objective is not to extract energy but to store it, then how we should go? The blood glucose level straight away can be converted to a polymer. We call it as glycogen. Okay, so glycogen is a biopolymer like starch. Or else we have the second option where acetyl coenzyme A can also be converted to energy storage of energy. So here acetyl CoA is utilized for the synthesis of fatty acids. Okay, so these are the two ways. So why do we have two types of mechanisms here? That's again a very interesting situation, because here, let's say when you have money, okay, when you have only 10 rupees, $10, you keep it in your pocket, okay. Let's say when you have 10,000, then where you will do, where you will keep? You keep it in bank, and then through ATM, you can withdraw money, Okay, let's say when you have so much of money, what you will do? You go on buying gold, or otherwise invest, or real estate, what not. Okay, if you compare these three with our case here, the $10 you have in your pocket is a highly liquid money, like the glucose that you have in blood. Okay, the 10,000 you have in bank with a little bit of restrictions, you can access the money just like ATM card. So this is quick accessible energy, we call it as glycogen. Okay, all others, like whenever you have invested and then you need a further more process, a bigger process is needed for extracting energy, for obtaining money. So it is almost like a fatty acid. So these are the three levels of accessibility of energy is there in our body, built in our body. In human liver, you will find approximately 50 grams per kg body weight glycogen will be there, and also in skeletal muscles, because these are the two tissues where glycogen is synthesized. Okay, so that's the reason. So overall you will have approximately 600 grams of glycogen in 70 kg male. Okay, so this is the basic calculation. This much glycogen will be there in our body. Usually it is sufficient to run our machine for 2 days, means 48 hours. Let's say if you go on fasting, so this glycogen is sufficient to run your system for 48 hours. Friends, this is the microscopic picture of glycogen, liver tissue, where you will find glycogen like these small granules. Okay, all these dark granules are nothing but glycogen. So glycogen, as I told you, is a polymer. So how actually the polymer exists? So this looks like more like starch only. In starch you have amylose and amylopectin. Okay, amylose and amylopectin. Amylose is a linear polymer. It looks like this. G, 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 G. It will go on like that. Amylopectin is like this. It will go up to some extent like this, and then branching will be there. You will have branching. So here glycogen looks like amylose, but too many branchings will be there. Okay, so it is like a tree which is growing. So from here it is coming like this, and we have one branch here, there is another branch here, and again it is growing like this, where so many branches are there. So many branches are there. Okay, so when it is expanding, as you move from inside out, it is expanding. So that's the reason why, if you see in three dimensions, it looks like a granule. It looks like a granule sphere. Okay, it looks like a granule. So here you will see 1, 4 glycosidic linkage, as well as 1, 6 glycosidic linkage. 1, 6 linkage will also be there. So this is the first carbon, this is the sixth carbon. Okay, and both are getting connected. So 1, 6 linkage as well as 1, 4 linkage, both will be there in glycogen. So in here, if you closely observe the structure of glycogen, you will see this growing branches. Growing branches is what we have, what I told you, the growing branches. So inner part, which is buried inside the granule, or what we call them as inner branches, and those branches which are accessible to the enzymes, or what we call them as outer branches. Okay, so this is about the structure of a glycogen granule, glycogen granule. Okay, so if you see the process of glycogenesis as well as glycogenolysis, the process is relatively very simple and straightforward. Very few steps are involved, and all the chemical reactions happen at lightning speed, very quickly. So that's why glycogenesis as well as glycogenolysis both happens at a relatively higher speed. Both glycogenesis and glycogenolysis, they share biochemical pathways to some extent, like glycolysis and gluconeogenesis, they share some biochemical pathways. So in the same way, here also glycogenolysis as well as glycogenesis both share some biochemical pathways. Let's see first glycogenesis. This is only an outline. I'll explain you the detailed chemistry in the coming slides. Okay, in the beginning, glucose is converted to glucose 6 phosphate. So this is the common starting reaction for even glycolysis. Okay, so once it is glucose 6 phosphate is generated, let's say in the body, when energy storage is very high, because very high ATP is there and not much energy is needed, then glycolysis reactions will be decelerated. And further, if insulin is there, in the presence of insulin, okay, the glycogenesis pathway is catalyzed. So hence glucose 6 phosphate will be converted to glucose 1 phosphate, means the phosphate group is shifted from 6th carbon to 1st carbon via phosphoglucomutase. Is a very important enzyme which is tuned by presence of insulin. Okay, then glucose 6 phosphate, glucose 1 phosphate reacts with UTP, uridine triphosphate, just like ATP. Okay, UTP is also a high energy compound, and then it will give UDP glucose. This is a high energy form where UDP is attached to the first carbon. So that will react with glycogen, which is already formed over there. Okay, so which is already formed, this glycogen, and then the chain will grow. The chain will grow. Okay, so this is the way. This is the way how glycogen is biosynthesized. What does it mean? It means we have to start from some initiator. Already formed glycogen, if it is there, then only glycogenesis is possible. The only thing that we are doing is either elongating the chain is glycogenesis. Okay, is glycogenesis, and breaking the chain or removing sugars from the chain is nothing but glycogenolysis. Okay, is nothing but glycogenolysis. So it is as simple as that. Now when glycogenolysis has to happen, what kind of biochemical can activate it? Let's say if insulin is activating glycogenesis, then what should actually activate glycogenolysis or catalyze glycogenolysis? It is glucagon. One is glucagon. The another very powerful activator of glycogenolysis is adrenaline. Okay, adrenaline is another hormone. So what happens in the beginning is glycogen, in the presence of phosphorylase, is the enzyme. It will degrade glycogen, so that from glycogen one unit of glucose is released. One unit of glucose is released. Then this glucose will be converted to glucose 6 phosphate, and then this glucose 6 phosphate will be provided to glycolysis. Okay, will go to glycolysis. It is as simple as that. Glycogen, in the presence of phosphorylase enzyme, which is positively tuned with the signaling molecules glucagon and adrenaline, so that the phosphorylase will cut down one glucose molecule from glycogen chains, and then glucose 1 phosphate will be released. This glucose 1 phosphate will be converted to glucose 6 phosphate in the presence of phosphoglucomutase, so that this glucose 6 phosphate will be submitted to glycolysis, so that energy will come. So friends, this is the way how glycolysis and glycogenesis and glycogenolysis are connected to each other. And one more very important thing about glycogen granule is, if you see in case of glycogen, as I told you, the branching grows. If this is the core molecule, okay, in this way the chain is growing, and then you will have a branch, you will have a branch, and you will have a branch, you will have further branching. Okay, so if you closely observe, it has various levels of branching. Okay, so we can use the word first tier, second tier, fourth tier, etc. So here in this figure it is clearly mentioned. Okay, first level, second level of branching, this is third level of branching, this is fourth level of branching, and it is in fact expanding in that way. As you are expanding, the number of carbohydrate units and chains are increasing in such a manner that it results it reflects in the diameter of the fragment. Okay, so smaller and then more glucose, more glucose, more glucose, very big, the diameter is actually increasing. And number of glucose glycosyl units is also increasing as you go from one tire to another tire. Usually, up to eighth tire is what we can see normally in glycogen in skeletal muscles as well as liver. But you can go only up to 12 tires because branches become so complicated that glycogen synthase cannot access the terminal glucose unit of glycogen chains. So friends, this is the way how glycogen granule structure is there in our skeletal muscle as well as liver. Here, there are two forms of muscle glycogen are there. So as I told you earlier, glycogen formation is actually elongation of already formed glycogen. Already formed glycogen means what? Where actually glycogen is there? So in case of skeletal muscle as well as in liver, okay? The story starts like this. Glycogenin is a protein which will be there in our body by the time we are born, or sometimes even before we are born. Okay, glycogenin will be there. So glycogenin protein contains, it is a simple albumin, okay, protein. And to this, at one terminal you have at 194 position you have tyrosine. What is tyrosine? Tyrosine is an aromatic amino acid with the hydroxy group, okay, NH and C double bond O, and you will have growing amino acid chain. It will go on like that. So that's why, so from the chain, let's say if we have tyrosine over here, you will have a hydroxy group here, okay. So normally what will happen before we are even born, this hydroxy group is activated with the help of kinases, and then the hydroxy group is glycosylated. Glucose units are added. Okay, so as many as 8 glucose units are added. 8 glucose units are added. Okay, so this is what we call it as proglycogen. Proglycogen. Okay, so glycogenin is the protein to which we have fully glycosylated glycogenin primer for the synthesis of proglycogen. So this is what we call it as proglycogen. And from here, the chain will grow, and then you will have, okay, basic structure that is formed like this. This acts as a platform for further growing or further branching, debranching, as well as lengthening of the chains. So this is what we call it as proglycogen. This is what we call it as fully matured glycogen granule, or otherwise macroglycogen. So in our body, approximately 75% of proglycogen will be there, and 25% of macroglycogen will be there. Means that is fully loaded glycogen. Proglycogen is actually acid insoluble, and macroglycogen is acid soluble. In our body, 75% of proglycogen and 25% of macroglycogen will be there. So in the glycogen synthesis, as we have seen in the last slide, first step involved in glycogen synthesis is phosphorylation. This is a common reaction for glycolysis as well as glycogenesis. The next one is phosphoglucomutase. Phosphoglucomutase shifts phosphate group from first carbon to, so from the sixth carbon to first carbon. Okay, the phosphate group has been shifted minus two, I think. Okay, then it will be made to react with UTP, uridine triphosphate. So the, if this is uridine, you have phosphate, and we have glucose 1 phosphate is there. So here UDP glucose and then pyrophosphatase is enzyme, so that will break down this one pyrophosphate ring molecule and then glucose OP to this the phosphate will be added, uridine. So and then pyrophosphate is released. So here how much energy is released? Approximately 40 kilojoules of energy is released. PPA is also a high energy molecule because the phosphoric anhydride bond will be there. This upon degradation also will release some energy, but this is a high energy molecule, okay, GDP, and this is UDP. This is UDP, so that's the way we call it as UDP glucose. This is UDP glucose. This UDP glucose will be made to react with glycogen synthase so that the growing chain is accessed by glycogen synthase, a 1,4 glycosidase enzyme, so that the sugar is attached to growing chain of glycogen. So to this oxygen, it is added over here. This bond is newly formed, so that the chain is growing like this. Okay, so this is the way how glycogen synthesis happens. One more step is there, where let's say when you have a linear polysaccharide, why linear polysaccharides are not very much encouraged? Because in the linearity there is orderliness and there is very low entropy. So that's the reason why linear and orderly structures, they are not encouraged as far as energy is concerned, because you are supposed to store energy. Storing of energy means you are forcing the molecule to stay in a stable form. So that's why built up of entropy is not at all acceptable. So this could be one reason why in our evolutionary cycle, so the branching of sugars happened. Okay, so this is a core molecule from where the chains have grown. Okay, so in the chains, when the chain is growing, when it reaches a level more than 11 sugars, okay, so the terminal sugar units are shifted to or transferred to the nearby growing chains of glycogen, so that branching is possible. So how it is happening? Now let's see here. At least 11 units need to be there in the growing chain, from where, okay, at least 4 units will be shifted to the nearby growing chain. So thereby, so one of the chain is shortened, the nearby chain got a branch. So it is like that. In this way, shifting of otherwise branching happens. Okay, so this is also called, the enzyme that is involved over here is also called as branching enzyme, or otherwise we call it as glycosyl 4,6 transferase enzyme. So friends, this is the way how glycogen synthesis happens. Now let's focus on glycogenolysis. Okay, so basically this is, if you take for example one of the chain that we have in glycogen, in glycogen we can have 1,6 bond as well as 1,4 bond. Okay, so 1,6, 1,4, what does it mean? So this is 1,6 glycosidic bond, this is a normal 1,4 glycosidic bond. Now from here we are supposed to get glucose 1 phosphate, and the enzyme that we make use of here is phosphorylase enzyme, which takes in 1 pi and then conduct this reaction so that glucose 1 phosphate is released. And once it is released, it will be converted to glucose 6 phosphate with the help of phosphoglucomutase. Phosphoglucomutase is the enzyme which does this job. So if it is a straight chain polymer, then we would not require any other kind of enzymes, but we do have, because when it is degrading the phosphorylase enzyme, it will stuck with a branching point over here. So that's the reason why this type of nicks are to be eliminated. So how it is done? So in case of 1,6 bonds, so what it actually does is like it will hydrolyze the 1,4 linkage that is over here, and then it shifts this entire molecule to this nearby chains. So it is virtually, what it is doing is the reversal of branching enzyme, where the shift is happening in the reverse order. But here, while shifting, it leaves the carbon with the 1,6 bond. Okay, there is a separate enzyme is there which does the job. Here the enzyme, we call it as glycosyl 4,4 transferase, which breaks 1,4 linkage, also makes 1,4 linkages. So that's why we call it as 4,4 transferase, glycosyl 4,4 transferase. Now the 1,6 bond is actually degraded by one specific enzyme, we call it as amylo 1,6 glucosidase. So it breaks up the glycosidic link between the sugar over here and then this sugar, thereby we get the free glucose. So these free glucose will be submitted to glycolysis. Okay, glycolysis. So friends, this is the way how glycogenesis as well as glycogenolysis is happening in our body. Now let's see its significance. Glycogen is a readily available, readily accessible energy as far as our skeletal muscles are concerned, okay, and essential tissues are concerned. But on larger rate, our skeletal muscles are the main consumers as far as glycogen is concerned. So in the exercise, glycogen consumption as well as oxygen consumption, okay, so when the rate of utilization, okay, when the rate of utilization of glycogen means when physical activity happens at a rapid rate, okay, the glycogen consumption is always proportional to this accelerated physical activity, where significant consumption of glycogen happens. And because when things are happening at rapid state, like instead of walking, let's say if you are jogging, obviously your oxygen input will also be increased, so thereby utilization of energy happens pretty quickly, whereas when you do the work slowly, the consumption of glycogen, or otherwise glycogen depletion rate, is very very less. Okay, in the same way, the same thing is reflected over here, oxygen consumption percentage. Okay, so if you see this one, as we lose glycogen, we lose our strength. Okay, so we slow down our processes, thereby our need for oxygen also goes down. So you can take it in this way, and in the next way, in the next one, how actually glycogen recovery, recovery of glycogen happens. Because the, let's say when somebody here in this graph, you can see the effects of exhausting exercise and diet on quadriceps muscle glycogen content. Exhausting exercise depletes glycogen content in active muscle. A rest and high carbohydrate diet results in a glycogen overshoot, okay, super compensation in exercised muscle only, because exercised muscle will retain, okay, the memory of its requirements. Hence, it will overload itself with glycogen. And in this graph, you can see the relation between food, exercise, and carb diet on rate of recovery of glycogen levels in your body. So here in the first graph, let's say if you see, when you are provided with mixed diets containing fiber, protein, fat, and carbohydrate, the rate of recovery, or otherwise the increase in glycogen levels, is not very much significant. But if you replace that one with carbohydrate-rich food, then immediately the rate of increase in glycogen production shoots up. Okay, so here it is in the mixed food, and then the subject is asked to work. And while working, you can see physical work significantly reduces, depletes the glycogen levels. But immediately, if you provide that subject with carbohydrate-rich diet, immediately the glycogen reserves are recovered. And in the third study, up to this one is common, but after, immediately after the exercise, when the subject is provided with fat and protein, okay, only fat and protein, then they did not observe quick rise in the glycogen levels. Quick rise in the glycogen levels is not there. But immediately when the subject is provided with carbohydrate-rich diet, immediately glycogen reserves shot up in a very short period of time. Very short period of time. So that's the reason why you can say that food has a significant impact on glycogen levels or glycogen recovery rate. Glycogen storage diseases, where we have three different diseases are there. One is type 1 disease, means very severe, and glycogen storage diseases. Type 1 disease is Van Gierke disease, where glucose 6 phosphate defect will be there. Glucose 6 phosphatase enzyme. Okay, so hypoglycemia occurs due to defect in the final step of gluconeogenesis. This disease affects only liver and renal tubule cells. Decreased mobilization of glycogen because of glucose 6 phosphatase defect, phosphatase, okay, you cannot recover glucose from glycogen. So thereby glycogen levels stays inside and they keep on growing. It leads to hepatomegaly. This is a severe form of glycogen storage diseases, which often results in fatality. The second one is McArdle disease, where skeletal muscle glycogen phosphatase is defective. Here, what happens is skeletal muscle is affected, whereas the liver enzymes are normal. Here, exercise capacity is greatly reduced because in the last slide we have seen, like in case of exercise or physical activity, skeletal muscle glycogen levels are actual providers for as far as energy is concerned. So here in the McArdle disease, the glucose cannot be recovered from skeletal muscle glycogen. So thereby exercise capacity is greatly reduced. Hypoglycemia during exercise is a very common symptom. And there is no rise in blood lactate during strenuous exercise because the skeletal muscle is not at all receiving enough glucose. So thereby the question of exercise doesn't occur over here. So the muscle contains a high level of glycogen with a normal structure. In type 6 Harris disease, liver glycogen phosphorylase is defective. Liver glycogen phosphorylase is defective. So the liver is affected, whereas the skeletal muscle enzymes are normal. Here, marked hepatomegaly occurs due to high level of glycogen with the normal structure. And following administration of glucagon, you will not see any rise in blood glucose. Okay, the responsiveness of glycogen to external stimuli is minimized or otherwise nullified. So these are the three very important glycogen storage diseases that we see in patients. So friends, With this, I conclude today's lecture. So today what we have seen is glycogen synthesis as well as utilization. Okay, means glycogenesis and glycogenolysis. Glycogenesis is stimulated by glycogenesis is an anabolic reaction. Okay, because we are storing energy in the form of sugar. So here insulin is the very important for hormone which catalyzes glycogenesis, whereas glycogenolysis means energy is needed is stimulated by glucagon as well as epinephrine, or otherwise adrenaline, epinephrine. Okay, so these two are very powerful activators for glycogenolysis. And glycogen storage diseases are like whenever and wherever glycogen storage or otherwise utilization are affected, it often leads to fatality. They are all very dangerous diseases. Okay, dear friends, I hope you understood the subject. If you have any doubts, please let me know in the comment section. And I thank all of you for your time, and I will see you again with another very interesting lecture soon. Thank you.